Alright everybody, you guys know the deal. Special video again, this is going to be why I feel Eze is a must-own game on the Switch. So yeah, sit back, listen to what I gotta say, and then insult me in the comments once you're done. Please be sure to leave a like, comment, share. Roll it! Eze 8 is an action-based adventure RPG developed by Falcom. You know, those people who brought us other gems like The Legend of Heroes, Trails in the Sky, and Trails of Cold Steel series, and all the other Eze games? Yeah, so the Eze series is one of those that likes to release games in a random order, and it's up to you to figure out what should come first. So, to no surprise, Lacrimosa of Donna lies in 6th place in regards to the overall chronological order. But luckily for us, there's no need to worry. The story is set up in a way to where you don't really need to play any of the other games to understand this one. I say this not because I'm some sort of Eze mega fan, but because this is my very first Eze game and I had no trouble following along with the story. This game does a very good job of easing you into everything. From my understanding, in each game you're following the same main character, just traveling different corners of the planet, allowing to keep the series fresh, naturally introducing new characters and giving us new tales to dive into and explore. In this instance, Lacrimosa of Donna starts us off on a ship, where we learn that our main character, Adol Kristen, is hitching a ride to continue his journey to the continent of Aresia. In exchange for a ride, he's been on the ship, the Lombardia, helping out as a deck boy. During this time on the Lombardia, he begins to build a relationship with the captain. The captain shares with us a tale of a cursed legendary island named the Isle of Sairin. We learn that apparently this island and the ocean around it is extremely dangerous, and anyone that comes near it is pretty much swallowed up and gifted with death. And if you're even lucky enough to make it onto the island, you're pretty much dead anyways because of the dangerous creepy crawlies waiting to get you there. Knowing this, you'd think we'd try to avoid it at all costs, but nope, the captain was way too busy swabbing someone's poop deck because it seems like no one was watching in what direction the ship was headed, and we plunged ourselves right into danger. This game suddenly turns into a scene from your favorite hentai film as we're under attack by these mysterious Venus flytrap looking tentacles. We try to stop these throbbing meat rods, but our efforts were in vain. The ship gets wrecked and our story finally begins with us waking up washed up on shore and yep, you guessed it, the cursed Isle of Sairin. This is where you first get a taste as to how grand this adventure is going to be. The map looks freaking huge, and backs up why Adol's dash move is crazy fast and explains why it was so awkward in that cramped little ship. We wake up and quickly realize that we're freaking stranded and decide to explore the island to see if we can find anyone else that happened to survive that shipwreck too. This game is definitely no God of War or Red Dead 2 with their near realistic visuals, but that is not to say that this game isn't beautiful itself. It's built to the brim with beautiful scenery and lively environments thanks to the overflow of monsters waiting for you to get eaten by them. This brings me to something that I wanted to mention. Be very cautious when playing the game. Usually with these types of action RPGs, I'm used to just button mashing my way to the end credits, but here I was given quite the surprise when I saw how hard enemy attacks hit, forcing you to rely on your flash guard and dodge roll a lot more frequently, and not just using it when you're bored trying to get yourself from point A to point B. On a side note, since we're already kind of talking about combat, I really enjoyed how seamless switching through the characters is, and how each one is unique and very fun to play. Personally, I had a lot of fun switching through characters and experimenting to see which three would be my favorite to have in my party. For the most part, I stuck with Sahad. I was surprised with him because I usually hate using slow attacking characters, but the devs really thought up of some cool animations to keep his playstyle really fun and effective. I also used Hummel, cause you know, Gunblade, I mean, what else is there to say? And of course I gotta keep your boy Adol in the party, so he's my third party member. I had trouble just sticking to one, but I'm weird and I feel like I'll spoil my experience if I'm not using the main character, even though it doesn't really matter. As we gradually find more people who survived the crash, the gang devises up a game plan for survival and begins to build a little community. The developers over at Falcom really surprised me with how they went about this. They really let the creative juices flow on this one. It may sound silly, but I completely lost my shit when they explained how they use potions. I mean, you legit need an empty jar and you brew up your own potion. Pour it in the jar, and when you use it, the jar gets empty again, waiting for you to fill it up with another medicinal concoction. Medicinal concoction. I am so sorry. Typical JRPGs just had me so used to buying them from item shops and selling the random stuff you find on your adventure for money. But in this game, everything you find has a purpose, and it doesn't end there. As we progress through the game, you find other people who washed up ashore just as you. But in this game, it's not out of convenience to find someone specifically to use in your party and to advance the story. But there are people who you need to find to help you with simple tasks. Like, for example, we're obviously going to need to fortify new equipment to help ourselves during our adventure. So instead of the game having us just be our own blacksmith, we actually find a blacksmith on the Isle of Sairin, who also was aboard the Lombardia. We take them back to our slowly developing village and we build them a workstation out of available materials for blacksmithing. It doesn't just stop there though, the devs went all in on the special features. They even went as far as to integrate raids into the game's story. These raids basically turn Lacrimosa of Donna into your typical Hyrule Warriors slash Fire Emblem heroes hack and slash, and we have to defend our village from, yep, you guessed it, a raid of beasts native to the Isle of Sairin. Then, after the first raid in the game, the cast is now aware that they have to create a plan to build up their defenses around the base, just in case it happens again. Ease 8 does a really good job with simulating being stranded by encouraging you to explore not only for developing the plot, but to find new items and ingredients in order to craft new items and wares that will help you out on your adventure. All in all, I feel that Ease 8 Lacrimosa of Donna is a must-own game for the Nintendo Switch. It's very rich with its content, special features, gameplay, and on top of all of that, it has an immersive world that just leaves you wanting more. I really hope you enjoyed the video. This has been Blank, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye.